Starship is supposedly the future of space launch vehicles. But what if I told you that the mission profile for the Artemis 3 moon mission is very much an old hat? Or rather, an old bearskin cap? Hello everybody and welcome! Over the past couple of years, the stainless steel Starship launch vehicle has been the focus of most of the space news stories here on YouTube, or anywhere for that matter. And it's not hard to understand why. Together with its super heavy booster, it stands over 100 meters tall, gets thrown into space by 33 Raptor engines, and both it as well as the booster can land when returning from space to be reused shortly after. Or rather, they will. Eventually. There are still a lot of kinks to be ironed out. In a couple of years, currently set for 2027, a lunar variant of Starship is planned to deliver the first astronauts back to the surface of the moon more than 50 years after the last humans had been there. The plan how to do it, however, is not new. In fact, most of the Starship's mission profile, regardless of its destination, is not that new, at least not in principle, because the Soviets had a very similar idea already in the early 1960s. Today, I'm going to tell you about that and also show you how it would have worked by recreating it in Kerbal Space Program. Some of you might remember my N1 replica I did a couple of years back. Well, we're going to look at it again, but now with all the glory of modern KSP graphical mods. And if that is to your liking, hit that subscribe button. We recently crossed the 100,000 subscriber threshold and I would really like to keep the momentum here going. I know a lot of you joined this channel to stay in touch with what happens regarding Kitten Space Agency, the current spiritual successor to KSP after its official sequel was shut down a year ago. Don't worry, as soon as there's news around that, you'll hear it on this channel. So, what was this curious mission plan the Soviets cooked up more than 60 years ago? As I alluded to, it involved the N1 rocket, the Soviets' attempt of building a launcher that could get a moon mission done. And yes, this particular mission would have the moon as its target, but not the scaled-down version that we talked about a while back in my Rocket Rumble video where I compared the LK lander with the Apollo lander. Link to that video is up top and in the description. What we'll talk about today would have required 3 launches of the N1, a 4th launch by an R7, orbital refueling, and a bonkers semi-upside-down lander. We can already see similarities with how the lunar Starship mission is set up. Multiple launches of the Starship and super heavy booster vehicle, orbital refueling, and a rather bonkers lander. There's also another similarity we'll talk about in a little while. First, let's get into the details of the Soviet plan. 2 N1 launches would deliver tankers into an orbit with an altitude of roughly 300 kilometers. These vehicles were called 21K and would have a total mass of 75 tons each, 65 of which would have been propellant to be transferred to the translunar acceleration stage. That would have been launched with a 3rd N1 launch and would also weigh in at somewhere between 73 and 75 tons. It was called 19K and it would be a rather complex piece of engineering. From the bottom up, there was a maneuvering tug, the lunar transfer stage, which would be launched empty, a lunar braking stage, and the lunar landing and ascent vehicle. You might notice that I haven't mentioned a crew compartment. Don't worry, we'll get to that. The 2 21K tankers would rendezvous with the 19K lunar complex and interface with the maneuvering tug to deliver propellant to the translunar acceleration stage. After all that was done, the mass of the vehicle would exceed 200 tons. Only then would the crew module be launched and attached. This was basically a variant of the Soyuz spacecraft and it would attach right at the front of the 19K vehicle. Due to this peculiar design, the Soyuz's engine was pointing in the opposite direction of the translunar acceleration stage's engines. Basically, the cosmonauts would have flown upside down from then on. Luckily, there is no up or down in microgravity. And to me, this is also similar to the plan for the Artemis 3 moon landing. While the lunar Starship is being refueled in Earth orbit and travels to the moon all on its own, The crew will arrive there via different transportation, aboard the Orion capsule, which is going to be launched with the SLS rocket. By the way, a lot of what I'm talking about in this video is based on information freely available on RussianSpaceWeb.com, run by journalist Anatoly Zak. While the site's design is almost as historic as the concepts we discuss in this video, it is still a treasure trove of information regarding the old Soviet space program as well as current developments within the Russian space industry. I believe this type of content should be supported, and you can do that by either donating or unlocking the insider content section for $50 a year. And if you want to support my work here, you can do so over on Patreon, where you can watch all my videos ad-free for even less. All right, so let's get to the most exciting part of a moon mission, the actual moon part. Once fueled up and connected to the crew vehicle, the 200-ton lunar complex would ditch the maneuvering tug and fire up the engines of the translunar acceleration stage. Once spent, the lunar braking stage would be used for trajectory corrections and a direct descent maneuver. This means that the Soviets hadn't planned for this particular vehicle to get into a stable orbit around the moon, they just wanted it to fly there directly and land, similar to various uncrewed moon missions they performed during the space race era. This approach, and a couple of other things we'll talk about later, is of course a big difference to how the Artemis 3 mission architecture is laid out. It requires rendezvous in lunar orbit before descending to the surface. After the 19K arrived at the moon, its remaining structure that actually landed on the moon would come down to a mere 21 tons, roughly a tenth of the mass of the combined vehicle after refueling. On the moon, the cosmonauts would perform surveys, grab some moon rocks, and of course plant a Soviet flag or two. Always important to plant that flag. The orbital module of the Soyuz would serve as habitation while on the moon. It would not have been as gigantic as the lunar starship, but still, it would have been a bit of a climb from that Soyuz on top of the 19K lander down to the surface of the moon. And Starship is going to have a lift, not a ladder. I mean, that thing is basically the size of the Tower of Pisa, so climbing it with a cumbersome spacesuit might be even a bigger risk than relying on the additional mechanical complexity of the lift. Whether their entry hatch was high up or not, once the surface tasks were completed, it was time for the cosmonauts to head back. For this, the main engine of the lander would fire up and use a direct ascent back to Earth, again for going in orbit around the moon. Once on their way to Earth, the crew portion of the vehicle would separate, basically resulting in being just a Soyuz on its way back to Earth. And here we have the usual profile. It would separate into three elements: orbital module, crew module, and service module. Only the crew module can survive atmospheric reentry and land back on Earth using parachutes and solid rocket motors to reduce the impact. Artemis 3, on the other hand, would have their astronauts switch vehicles again in lunar orbit back to the Orion capsule, leaving the lunar starship back there. And yes, there are of course a lot of other differences. For instance, the original Soviet plan would have required four launches of disposable rockets. Basically, they would have used 3N1 rockets just to get the required materials into orbit. Starship, on the other hand, is designed to be fully reusable. But it will require more than a dozen refueling flights in order for the lunar Starship to be fueled up. That's a lot! And each launch adds more complexity to the mission. That's already 17 launches for Artemis 3, one for the Starship propellant depot in orbit, 14 for the refueling flights, one more for delivering the lunar Starship into orbit, refuel it, and then send it to lunar orbit, and one more launch for SLS to send Orion up to the moon. Then there's docking. Again, 17 times is the number of required operations. 14 times for the tankers to dock to the depot and fill it up, one time for lunar Starship to refuel, and two times docking with Orion in lunar orbit. That makes the three required docking maneuvers of the Soviet moon architecture almost tame in comparison. But of course, back in 1963, nobody had yet done anything like that before. The first ever docking of two spacecraft was performed in 1966 by Gemini 8. the Soviets only managed to do it more than a year later. And even today, in 2025, nobody so far has ever transferred cryogenic propellant in space. There have been fluid transfer demonstrations aboard the ISS, but nothing at the scale of Starship or the temperatures required to keep liquid oxygen, well, liquid. Regarding timeline, the Artemis program had originally planned to land humans back on the moon by the end of 2024. However, due to multiple delays in development, the current timeline says no earlier than 2027, which is at least 2 years away. Starship development has come a long way in the meantime, but a lot of mission-critical capabilities like docking and propellant transfer have not yet been demonstrated. The only hardware of the Artemis architecture that has been tested successfully so far is the SLS rocket and the Orion capsule. Personally, I have my doubts that everything will be in place for a successful and safe moon landing mission in 2027. But what do you think? Will Artemis 3 put human beings back onto the surface of the moon for the first time since 1972? Or will the Chinese overtake the United States in that aspect? Let me know in the comments down below. Also, what do you think about the very ambitious Soviet moon landing concept from 1963? Was it too ambitious for the time? I mean, we now know that the N1 failed to even put a test payload into orbit during its 4 launch attempts. But also, chief designer Sergei Korolev had died before his big rocket ever reached the launch pad. Maybe he could have made some tweaks that could have saved it. A lot of maybes and what ifs, but then again, I am a sucker for alternative timelines and mulling over scenarios like these. And if you like what I'm doing here on my channel, you can support me over on Patreon or by becoming a YouTube member. People on the higher tiers get early access to videos, and also your name will show up here together with all of these wonderful people. Thank you so much for your support. If I ever manage to get this channel financially viable without sponsorships, it will be due to people like you who are willing to put their money behind creators they want to see thrive. The Soviet space program is long gone, but apparently a lot of its ideas live on, or have been rediscovered by modern rocket engineers. And why not? Even if Starship indeed borrowed from a 60-year-old architecture, it is not always necessary to reinvent the wheel. But it's always a good idea to think about how you can improve on what is already there, standing on the shoulders of giants and all that jazz. In that vein, what is an older space concept you would like to see come to fruition? Personally, I'd love to see a comeback of winged spacecraft like the Space Shuttle. There's the X-37B and Dream Chaser, but they're kind of small in comparison. Also, space elevators! The concept exists for decades, but so far we got nothing. And I would really like to have an easier ride to space than what we have now.
If you enjoyed this video, please subscribe to my channel for more and follow me on my social thingies. The links are in the description. Thanks for watching. Goodbye.